In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. After St. Paul preached the Galatians, who were Gentiles, which means they were not Jewish, and they believed in Christ, and after they were baptized and received the Holy Spirit in the sacrament of chrismation, some false teachers from Jewish background started to teach them that in order to be justified, you need to keep all the works of the law. And some people from Galatia start to have doubts about the preaching of St. Paul when he preached that justification is through Christ, not through the works of the law. Otherwise, Christ died with no reason. If the works of the law can justify a person, then there is no reason for Christ to die. And St. Paul sent them this letter, and in the first four chapters, he made a very, very good argument to convince them and persuade them that justification is through our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, not through the works of the law. And in chapter 4, he explained to them that actually the law brings bondage. You are under bondage if you are following the law. But with Christ, actually, you receive freedom and liberty. And he used the example of Hagar and Sarah, the bondwoman and the free woman. And he said, those who are following the law and seeking justification by the law are the children of the bondwoman. But we, the Christians, who seek justification through our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are the children of the free woman. And that's how he concluded chapter 4, by affirming that we, the Christians, are the children of the free woman, not the children of the bond woman. In chapter 5, St. Paul starts to elaborate more about the concept of freedom and liberty in Christ. Because maybe some people will think that to be free from Christ, to free in Christ, this means to live as you want and to be indulged in all the works of the flesh. So St. Paul explained what does it mean to be free in the Lord Jesus Christ. He highlighted at least 3 points. Liberty means freedom from the dead works of the law. The works of the law that avail nothing. That's what liberty means. And also, through this liberty, through this freedom, we will choose by our free will to enslave ourselves to one another, to serve one another in love. So when we accept the law of liberty, the law of freedom, we will learn how to serve one another with our free will. And then he concluded by explaining that to be free in Christ means to walk in the Spirit and to live by the Spirit. That is the true liberty, is to walk in by the Spirit and to live in the Spirit. So in the first 6 verses from chapter 5, he spoke about our liberty in Christ. Let's read together from verse 1 and then let us explain. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made you free. And do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. St. Paul is saying, now Christ has set us free. Christ liberated us from the bondage of the law, from the curse of the law, from the sin. So you need to stand therefore, to stand fast therefore in this liberty, which means you need to do your effort and to fight the good fight in order not to be enslaved back to sin or to the dead works of the law. That's why he said, do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. And St. Paul used the word yoke. What is yoke? The yoke is this wooden beam which is used between a pair of oxen to allow them to pull a load. So the yoke is wooden beam. We put it on pair of oxen so they can pull a load. So St. Paul is saying, if you return back to the law, you are under this yoke. You are under this heavy burden. And you will do all this hard work, but without any benefit. Why without any benefit? Because the works of the law cannot justify you. So you will do all this burden. You will be under this heavy yoke, heavy burden, but you will not benefit anything because the law cannot justify you. But if you believe in Christ and to carry his yoke, as the Lord Jesus Christ said, carry my yoke. My yoke is light. So if we carry the yoke of Christ, actually, as I told you, yoke usually is put on two. So I will not be carrying the yoke by myself, but Christ also will be carrying the yoke with me. And if Christ is carrying the yoke with me, then actually he is carrying the heaviest load. Just I am in the picture. I'm not doing anything. Christ actually carrying all the yoke. That's why the Lord said, my yoke is light. Because we will receive the grace of God. He is the one who is carrying the whole load. So St. Paul is saying, now after you understand that we are the children of the free woman, Christ has set us free. We are called to liberty in Christ. We need to be steadfast in this liberty by which Christ has made us free. Do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Verse 2. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. When St. Paul said, I, Paul, means he's speaking with authority. I, Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ, I, Paul, who saw the Lord Jesus Christ and preached his gospel, I am telling you with all authority that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. What does it mean? St. Paul is telling them, If you believe that you will be justified by circumcision, if that's what you believe in, then your faith in Christ is not complete. Your faith in Christ is not true. As if you say, Christ cannot justify me. That's why I need to keep circumcision and all these deadly works of the law. That's why you will fall from the grace of God. and Christ will not profit you, which means you will fall from His grace. You will not be justified by Christ because you are not believing in Him. You still believe that you will be justified in the works of the law. So he said there are some consequences if you believe that you will be justified by the law. The first result will be Christ will not profit you, which means you will not be saved by Christ. And also the works of the law will not save you, so you will not be saved. The second consequence, we read it in verse 3. Am I testify again to every man? I testify again with my authority as an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. I testify to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. So, if you believe that you will be justified by circumcision, then you need to keep the whole law. And it is impossible for anybody to keep the whole law without breaking it. So you will not be justified. So number one, Christ will profit you nothing. Number two, you will be under the bondage, under this yoke of the law. You will carry the heavy load of the yoke again. And you will carry it, but it will not profit you anything. Because nobody can keep the whole law without breaking it and without losing his justification and his salvation. Verse 4, you have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from the grace. So that is number 3. The 3 results. If you are seeking to be justified by the law, you will be estranged from Christ. What does it mean? You will be a stranger. You will not be from the family of God. You will be as a stranger. After you were a stranger and then by believing in Christ, you became close and you became from His family and you became the son of Christ. But now when you deny that you are justified by Christ and you are seeking justification by the law, so you will be stranger from Christ. Not only that, but number 4, actually, you will fall from the grace of God. You will not enjoy the grace of God. You will be struggling by yourself. Because the law was given by Moses, but the grace and truth by Jesus Christ. And that is the main difference between justification by law and justification by Christ. Justification by law, you need to do all the work. And nobody can keep all the work, can keep the whole law. That's why nobody is able to be justified by the law. But when you believe in Christ, then you will have the grace of God with you. And you have the Spirit of God leading you. So it will be easy for you to be justified through believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. So there are 4 consequences if you are seeking justification by the law. Number 1, Christ will profit you nothing. Number 2, you will return back to the bondage of the law. You have to keep the whole law. Number 3, you will become a stranger from Christ. And number 4, you will fall from the grace of God. Verse 5, for we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Now St. Paul is explaining how we will be justified, how we will be righteous before God. That's why he called it the hope of righteousness. The hope of righteousness, to be righteous, to be justified before of God. He said, we are justified through the Spirit. Through the Spirit. You know, after the person believes, then he accept baptism. And in baptism, he take off the old man and put on the new man in Jesus Christ. And after baptism, in chrismation, he receives the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit dwells in me. You are the temple of God, and the Holy Spirit abides in you. Then, if the Holy Spirit abides in me, I receive the grace of God, and I become righteous through the work of the Spirit in me. So, that is how justification happens. It is through our faith in Christ, then we are baptized and we receive the Spirit, and through the Spirit we are waiting, eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Verse 6, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love. He said, circumcision is insignificant in your justification. So whether you are circumcised or uncircumcised, whether you keep the law or you don't keep the law, keeping the law means whether you are seeking justification through the law, through the works of the law, this will not profit you anything. It's very, very insignificant. What really avails is faith working through love. And when St. Paul used the word faith working through love, he wants to say he is not against the works, because faith without works is dead. Faith without works is nothing. So St. Paul, in his argument about we are justified by faith, not by the works, he is not attacking the good works or the good deeds, but he is attacking seeking justification through works without believing in Christ. So nobody can be justified through works, but when we believe in Christ, we will be justified. But this faith in Christ will be true faith if it is working through love. Because faith without works is dead. This is what we call the theoretical faith. Like the demons. The demons have this kind of faith. Faith is not just set of belief system. It's not only a creed that we recite. Faith is more than set of belief system or a creed. Faith is life. I live this creed. I live this belief system. It appears and manifests itself in my action. If you believe that God exists and God is love, then you need to show this love in your life. That's what faith is. Because demons have this kind of faith, the theoretical faith. They know the belief system. They know the creed. They know that God exists. They know that God is Holy Trinity. They know all of this. But this faith is dead for the demons because it is not faith working through love. So the true faith is the faith that works through love. Then from verse 7, St. Paul is saying that now if faith works through love, and love fulfills the law, then actually when you believe in Christ, you will fulfill the law. So there is difference between seeking to be justified by the law and fulfilling the law. You cannot be justified by the law, but because you believe in Christ, you will fulfill the law. Again, it is wrong to seek justification and righteousness through the law. But because of your faith in Christ, then you will fulfill the law. That's what St. Paul discussed from verse 7 to verse 15. He said in verse 7, you ran well. What does it mean? He said when you accepted Christ, you kept all the spiritual practices and the spiritual exercises in order to be filled with the Spirit of God. You ran well. You have fought the good fight. You were doing good through your faith in Christ and through the grace of God. Now, he is asking, who hindered you from obeying the truth? Who hindered you from obeying the truth? Who stopped you from following the truth, which is justification through our faith in Christ, not through the works of the law? Hindered, he is referring to the false teachers who hindered the work of grace in them by teaching them that justification is through the works of the law, not through faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why in verse 8 he said, this persuasion does not come from him who calls you. This persuasion is not from God who called you. It is from the false teachers who are deceiving you and want you to drift away from the truth into fables, into the falsehood. And then St. Paul is telling them in verse 9, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. So when you allow yourself to listen to the false teacher, don't say, you know, I know the whole truth, so this sermon will not affect me. No, little leaven will leaven the whole lump. You need to be very, very careful. A very small wrong or false doctrine actually can drift you away from the grace of God. A very small sin like a leaven in your heart can actually threaten your salvation. So be careful, because you use a very small amount of leaven and you put it in the dough, and then it will leaven the whole lump. In the same way, don't underestimate the power of the false teaching. Don't say, you know, just I go to this church to hear a good sermon and that's it. No, maybe you will listen to some false teaching, and this false teaching will leaven the whole lump and will threaten your salvation. Like the Galatians, after the ran well, because they allowed themselves to listen to these false teachers, then they start to drift away from the truth. And now actually their salvation is at risk. And St. Paul was concerned that they may fall from the grace of God. He had worries about them. So he told them, don't allow small teaching or a small connection with a false teacher threaten your salvation. But after he said this, he wanted to encourage them and to give them hope and confidence. That's why in verse 10 he told them, I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will have no other mind. And I like how St. Paul wrote it here. He said, I have confidence in you, in the Lord. He didn't say, I have confidence in you only. And he didn't say also, I have confidence in the Lord only. But he said, I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will have no other mind. You will have no other mind means you will not change your mind to seek justification through the works of the law. but you will seek justification through faith in Christ. But when he said, I have confidence in you in the Lord, means our confidence, in order to be true, it has to be in God and also in ourselves, which means God will do his part, will give me his grace, but I should do my part. If St. Paul said, I have confidence in the Lord that you will have no other mind, maybe some people will interpret this as if God will do everything. I don't have to do anything. God will do everything. If he said, I have confidence in you that you will have no other God, then they will do it by their effort, not by the grace of God. But he said, I have confidence in you, in the Lord. Which means, in order actually to achieve success in any activity, there is a divine element and a human element. You need to do your part, that's the human element. And the divine element is the grace of God. When we put these two elements together, then actually we will be saved. So our salvation based on the grace of God and also how we received this grace and how we respond to this grace. That's why he told them, I have confidence in you, so you have part, you have to do it in the Lord, that's the grace of God, that you will have no other mind. But he who troubles you, now he is referring to the false teachers, he who troubles you shall bear his judgment, whoever he is. God doesn't have partiality. So, whoever he is, God will judge him. And I want you to observe something. Although St. Paul was confident that they will not change their mind, but this doesn't mean that the false teachers will not be judged. In spite of their return, God will judge the false teachers. So those who cast doubts in the hearts of the people, whether the people actually drifted away or not, they will receive judgment from God. As St. Paul said, he who troubles you shall bear his judgment, whoever he is. The false teachers said to the Galatians that St. Paul also was preaching that in order to be justified, you need to keep the works of the law. So they tried to deceive them by saying St. Paul was preaching this. And he did not preach you because you are Gentiles. And St. Paul doesn't want you to be saved. He is preaching this to the churches of Judea because that's his people. But he is deceiving you because he doesn't care about you as much he cares about the churches of Judea. That's what the false teachers tried to convey to the church in Galatia. That's why St. Paul defended this false accusation. In verse 11, he told them, and I, brethren, and using brethren here in order to show them that he cares about them. Yes, they are Galatians, not Jewish from his people, but they are his brethren in Christ. So he cares about them. He cannot deceive them. They are his brethren. And I, brethren, if I still preach circumcision, why do I still suffer persecution? He told them, I want you to think and to make rationale. Now, the Jewish teachers, the false teachers, are persecuting me. Why they persecute me? If I am preaching that you will be saved through circumcision, then I shouldn't be persecuted. But the fact that I am persecuted until now, and I still suffer persecution, This proves that I don't preach justification through circumcision. So if I still preach circumcision, why do I still suffer persecution? Not only that, but the false teacher, why they were offended by the cross? The main offense when St. Paul taught them that justification is through faith in Christ. When you believe in his crucifixion, he died for you in order to save you. That's why they were offended. But if St. Paul preached that you will be justified by the works of the law, and it is a must for your justification. Besides, also Christ died in order to help us to be justified. Then the Jewish teacher will not be offended at the cross. Because those false teachers are Christian who believe in crucifixion and believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But they believe that crucifixion and resurrection are not enough to be justified. You have to keep the works of the law in order to be justified. So, if St. Paul is preaching justification through circumcision, then the offense of the cross will be ceased. People will not be offended at the cross, because that's exactly what they are preaching. But the fact that those false teachers, until now, they are offended by the cross, this means St. Paul is preaching justification through faith in Christ, not through the works of the law. That's what he said in verse 11. And I, brethren, if I still preach circumcision, why do I still suffer persecution? Then the offense of the cross has ceased. The offense of the cross has ceased. I could wish that those who trouble you would even cut themselves off. So St. Paul here show his anger or his zeal or his indignation against those false teachers. And when he said cut themselves off, means to cut themselves off the fellowship, of the communion, of the assembly of the believers. In other words, to be excommunicated. So St. Paul is saying, I wish that those who trouble you would even be excommunicated, be cut off from the fellowship. As he said in chapter 1, if anybody preached other gospel than what we preach to you, let him be cursed, let him be excommunicated. Even if an angel from heaven preached to you otherwise, let him be accursed. Verse 13, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. After St. Paul spoke about the doctrine of justification, now from verse 13, he will give us some practical application. And as I told you, faith is not set of beliefs, it's not just a creed. But for faith to be true, it has to be applied. That's why after St. Paul explained the doctrine of justification, now he is giving application, how I apply this doctrine in my life. And he said, your faith should be faith working through love. So he said, now you are free. You are free in Christ. But does this mean to use this liberty or this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, as an opportunity to be undisciplined, and to be indulged in the lusts of the flesh. And just here, I want to say what St. Paul means by the flesh and spirit. Because you will hear in the rest of this chapter, St. Paul is using the word flesh and spirit, flesh and spirit. So what does he mean by flesh and what does he mean by spirit? Flesh does not mean this flesh away from spirit. And spirit does not mean spirit away from the flesh. But St. Paul is speaking about the old man and the new man, the old nature and the new nature. The old nature is led by the lusts and the desires of the flesh. And these people, we call them the carnal people, because it is the desires of the flesh that lead their spirit and their flesh. The desires of the flesh lead their spirit and their flesh. And when he speaks about the spirit, he's speaking about the new man. The new man that we put on in baptism. As St. Paul said, when you were baptized, you put on Christ. You put on the new man. This new man, this has spiritual desires. And then, when we are led by this new nature, by the spiritual nature, we'll become spiritual people. And this spirit will lead both the spirit and the flesh. So now we have a carnal person and a carnal and a spiritual person. Or we have a carnal nature and a spiritual nature. So when St. Paul said, do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, he meant, do not use this liberty an opportunity to fulfill the desires of the carnal man or the desires of the carnal flesh, carnal nature. And he will elaborate at the end of the chapter about what are the works of the flesh. And you will see these works also are the works of the spirit and the flesh when a person is led by the desires of the flesh. So, do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh. So, you are free in Christ, doesn't mean you will do whatever you want to do. No, you have to be disciplined. That's why he said, but through love, serve one another. Serve means you will be like enslaved to others. But this, when I enslave myself, by my own liberty, by my own freedom, by my own free will, in order to fulfill the law of love. When I walk with you the extra mile, as if I am enslaving myself to you. But why I am doing this? Because of the new nature that I receive. Because of the love of God that abides in my heart. That's why I serve you. As if I enslaved myself to you. But actually, this is the true freedom, because through love, serve one another. So we have to use our liberty to serve one another in love. And thus, the law will be fulfilled. In verse 14, he said, for all the law is fulfilled in one word. Even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. They used actually to summarize the law, the Ten Commandments, into two commandments. The first four commandments, which regulate our relationship with God, they summarize it in one word, love God from your heart. And the second six commandments, they summarize it in one word, love your neighbor as yourself. So actually, if I want to summarize the Ten Commandments, they will be summarized in one word, which is love. Love God and love your neighbor. What's the difference between now when we fulfill the law as Christian and when we fulfill the law as Jewish? As Jewish, I want to keep these 10 commandments in order to be justified. But once I break one of these commandments, I'm not justified. I'm under curse forever. But in Christianity, I believe in Christ, and I received my justification through my faith in Christ, because keeping the law cannot justify me. Nobody will be able to keep the law without breaking it. That's why the law failed to justify any human being, because nobody was able to keep the law. But now, because now I am free in Christ, and I received the grace of God, so I am fulfilling the law. I am keeping the Ten Commandments as a fruit of my freedom in Christ. But if I used this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, and I don't keep the law, then I am despising the grace of God that He gave me. God gave me this gift in order to love one another, in order to serve one another. So if I receive this gift and I'm not using it in the right way, I am despising the grace of God as if I did not receive it. And that's why I will not be justified. And that's exactly how, again, His Holiness Pope Shenouda explained. We are not justified by works, but we will not be justified without them, because the works are the fruit of our faith in Christ. If we really believe in Him, and if we really receive this grace, then we will keep the law. So St. Paul is telling them, I'm not against you, I'm not against the law, I'm not asking you to break the law. No, I am against justification through the law, because you will not be justified by the law. But as Christian, we have to keep the law, and in love, we have to serve one another and to fulfill the whole law of God. That's why He told them, for all the law is fulfilled in one word, love. Even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. When we abuse our liberty in Christ, or when we under the law, what will happen? St. Paul mentioned in verse 15, but if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. So when we abuse our liberty in Christ, or when we are under the law, it will be an opportunity to consume and destroy one another. So St. Paul did not say, now you are justified by faith in Christ, so it's okay to bite one another, it's okay to devour one another, it's okay to fulfill all the desires of the flesh. No, that's abusing your liberty. That's despising the grace of God. And this actually will put your justification at risk. So as Christian, you are required to fulfill the law, not to seek justification through the law. That's why you need to be careful how we deal with one another. If we bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. Also, St. Paul is referring to something else. He told them, when you received Christ and you are walking in spirit, you have peace in your church. But now, when the false teachers entered your church, and now you are seeking justification through the law, what happened? Now there are divisions. You are biting one another and devouring one another and consuming one another. So does this mean you fall away from the grace of God? Yes, that's what happened. Now you are seeking justification through the law. That's why you fell away from the grace of God. That's why there is contention, division, and all this contention and division among you, because you fell away from the grace of God. From verse 16, St. Paul, to the end of the chapter, St. Paul will explain to us how to live our liberty, how to walk in the Spirit, because it is the Spirit of God that gives us this liberty. So as Christian, how to fulfill the law? As Christian, how in love we serve one another? As Christian, how we walk in Spirit? In verse 16 he said, I say then, as a conclusion, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So, in verse 13, he told them, do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh. How you do it? How you don't abuse your liberty and fulfilling the lust of the flesh? The antidote for this is to walk in the Spirit. So, when you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Walking in the Spirit means to follow the leadership of the Spirit of God, to be led by the Spirit, not by the desires of the flesh. The Spirit convicts you to repent, then you need to repent. That's walking in the Spirit. Spirit convicts you on righteousness, to pray, to communicate with God, then that's walking in the Spirit. Walking in the Spirit convicts you to do charitable deeds and good works, to be merciful to one another. That's walking in the Spirit. So when you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. But when you don't walk in the Spirit, then the flesh will take control. That's what St. Paul is saying. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. St. Paul is referring to the two natures, the old nature and the new nature, the carnal nature and the spiritual nature, that are fighting in me. Fighting, they want to take the leadership, to control me. So, either I will follow the lusts of the flesh, or I will follow the desires of the Spirit. If you follow the desires of the Spirit, you are walking in the flesh. You are walking in the Spirit. And thus, you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. But actually, if you fulfilled the desires of the flesh, then you will do, as St. Paul said, you do not do the things that you wish. You don't do the things that you wish. Let me give you an example. After tomorrow, the great fast will start. And you will have the Spirit and the flesh. The flesh will tell you, no, don't fast. Why you fast 55 days? That's too long. It's enough to fast only 2 weeks, or at least from the middle of the fast, or 40 days. Just take break for the first 2 weeks and start the last 40 days. This is the voice of the flesh. The Spirit will tell you, no, you need to participate in fasting. You need fasting. Fasting is a spiritual tool that God gave us to develop self-control. So you will have these two voices contrary to one another. One trying to pull you this way, and the other trying to pull you that way. Actually, if you listen to the voice of the flesh, then you will fall in many other sins, the sins of the flesh that St. Paul will describe in a few minutes. And you will do things that you do not wish. And you wonder, why I do all these things? You know why? Because you allowed the flesh to be in control. But if you follow the voice of the Spirit, then the grace of God will help you, will empower you. Then you will bear the fruit of the Spirit. And you can apply this on prayer, on attending the church. For example, tomorrow morning, the flesh will tell you, why you go early? No, they will read the gospel at 8:30 or 9 or whatever. So go at 9 will be enough. Why you go early to the church? The Spirit will remind you with the words of God. Those who come early to me, those who seek me early will find me. And now, which voice you will listen? Are you going to listen to the voice of the flesh or the voice of the Spirit? If you listen to the voice of the flesh, what will happen? You will do actually other sins, the works of the flesh, that you do not wish to do. But this is like a natural fruit from giving the leadership to the flesh. But if you give the leadership to the Spirit, then you will bear the fruit of the Spirit. That's what St. Paul is saying here. Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. If you are led by the Spirit, if you give the leadership to the Spirit, you are not under the curse of the law, because you will fulfill the law. You are not under the yoke of the law, because you fulfill the whole law. And this is actually the way of our justification. Verse 19. Now the works of the flesh are evident. St. Paul said, you will do things that you do not wish. Like what? So he gave us a list of the works of the flesh. Those who give the leadership in their life to the flesh, they will be tempted and may fall in one or more of these sins. What are this list? What is this list? Now the works of the flesh are evident. He said, they are known for everybody. I don't have to tell you what are the works of the flesh. But let me just mention to you what are the works of the flesh. Which are? Adultery. Adultery is unlawful relationship with a person from the other gender. That's adultery. Fornication. Fornication is all kinds of sexual immorality, including homosexuality. Uncleanness. Uncleanness is بالعربي مترجمة دعارة اللي هي prostitution. So uncleanness is when people, you know, their inside and their outside became completely unclean. So now their uncleanness is very, very clear and evident to everybody. And maybe those who commit adultery, they don't appear like unclean to others. Or those who fall in fornication, they don't appear unclean to others. But uncleanness, when the indulgence in the sexual sins are very, very clear to everybody, so we say it's like prostitution. Lewdness. Lewdness, when a person is preoccupied with sex and sexual desires, lustful. So not only practice sexual sins, but he is preoccupied, all his thinking, all his perception, he sees things in a sexual way. That's lewdness. Idolatry. Idolatry is the worship of idols, but it can also refer to the greed and love of money, or ego and pride. This can be also idolatry. Sorcery. Sorcery is magic and divination. All those who are using magic to know, for example, their fortune or their luck or the future, all these like psychic lines that are, you know, spreading right now. That's sorcery. Hatred. And I want you, hatred actually is a sin of the spirit, but St. Paul mentioned as works of the flesh, because as I told you, he does not speak here about flesh as flesh, but the carnal man, the old nature. Hatred is lack of love, and the desire to revenge, that's hatred. Contentions. Contentions, when there is conflict, fight, divisions. Jealousies. Jealousies, when I compare myself with other, and I wish to be in their place. Jealousy, also, when I desire bad things to happen to others. Outbursts of wrath, when a person cannot control his anger and explode this wrath, the explosive anger. Selfish ambition, when a person works for his own glory, to glorify himself. So his ambition is for his own glory, for his own pride, for his own ego. Dissension. Dissensions like divisions. Divisions in the church or in the family. Heresies. Heresies, false doctrines and teaching. And again, St. Paul said heresies is works of the flesh. Envy. Envy is lack of contentment. When I am not content with what I have, I start to envy others for what I do not have. Envy is usually to think about what you are lacking, not what you have. You are not counting your blessing, but counting what you are lacking. Murders, killing, drunkenness, like alcoholism and all kind of addiction. Revelries. Revelries actually is unruly merrymaking. What do I mean by this? Like the nightclubs, like, you know, the dancing in ballrooms, all this called revelries. اللي بيسموها بالعربي عربدة أو butter. So he mentioned some sins of the flesh, and he said, and the like. Lest somebody think that these are the only list of the works of the flesh. He said, I will give you some example. But if you give the leadership to the flesh, then most probably you will fall in one or more of these sins, because these are the works of the flesh, or similar sins. That's why he said, and the like. And then, as I told you, even if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are justified by his blood, but if you take this liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, your justification is at risk. Your salvation is at risk. That's why St. Paul said here, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. So don't say, I believed in Christ, I am saved, I will go to heaven no matter what. No. Yes, you believed in Christ and you are justified. But if you are abusing your liberty in Christ, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And St. Paul, he told them, I'm not giving you a new doctrine. When I visited you and when I preached Christ to you, that's what I told you in time past. And now I'm reminding you again, maybe you forgot, but those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But actually, if you give the leadership to the Spirit and you are walking in the Spirit, what will happen? You will bear the fruit of the Spirit. And what is the fruit of the Spirit? Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is. And here we have to notice, St. Paul used the word fruit in singular, not plural, although he mentioned 9 fruits. So how, maybe we expect to say the fruits of the Spirit are, as he said, the works of the flesh are, which are. Why he used singular, not plural? Because once you have one fruit, you will have all of them. So they are like a piece of diamond. It's one piece of diamond, but has nine faces or nine aspects. So the fruit of the Spirit is one fruit, but have nine dimension or nine aspects. And we can classify them into three groups. So the first group about, it comes from my relationship with God. Second, my relationship with others. And the third group, my relationship with myself. So the first group, love, joy, peace. From my relationship with God, God will abide in my heart. And then I will have this love. And the joy, as the Lord said, I will see you. And you will rejoice, and no one will take your joy away from your heart. And the peace, he is the King of peace. My peace I give to you, my peace I live with you. So, when you give the leadership to the Spirit, you will have these three fruits from your relationship with God. Love, joy, peace. In the relationship with others, you will be long-suffering. You will be kind. You will be good. Long-suffering, you will be patient. You will be patient for others. Kindness, you will have compassion. Your heart will be full of kindness and compassion and sympathy for others. Goodness, you will do good works, charitable deeds. You will help others. In love, you serve one another. So, the first three fruits, love, joy, peace, from my relationship with God. The second, from my relationship with other. I will be patient with other, long-suffering, kindness, full of compassion, goodness. I'll do good, no harm to others. And the last three, about my character. Who am I? Gentleness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I'll be a faithful person, honest person, trustworthy, gentleness. So in my character, I'll be gentle, meek, like the Lord Jesus Christ, when he said, learn from me, for I'm gentle and of lowly heart. You will be humble, gentle, meek. And self-control, you are well-disciplined, not unruly, but you have control over yourself and you control yourself very well. So these are the nine fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, relationship with God, then with one another, long-suffering, kindness, and goodness. And in my character, who am I? It will be faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such, there is no law. Again, when actually you have the fruit of the Spirit in your life, then you will not be under the curse of the law. There is no law will condemn you, but you will inherit the kingdom of God. Also, St. Paul wants to say the law cannot produce this fruit in you. So if you follow the law cannot produce such a fruit in you. Verse 24, and those who are Christ's, those who believed in Christ, those who seek justification through faith in Christ, have crucified the flesh with its passion and desires. So, walking in the Spirit has two dimensions. One dimension is to fulfill the voice of the Spirit who calls you to pray, to worship, to help others, to study the scripture, to meditate. All these spiritual exercises. But walking in the Spirit has another dimension, which is to actively crucify the flesh with its desires and passions. Lest somebody will think that automatically when I walk in the Spirit and do all these spiritual exercises, automatically I will get rid of all the sins of the flesh. But St. Paul is saying no. Here you need actively to crucify the desires and the passions of the flesh. Crucify means what? You will discipline them and control them through your relationship with the crucified Christ. Through the power of the cross, you will be able to crucify your flesh with its passion and desire. Desire are the internal desires. Passion, that's the expression of the desire. So the passion is the expression of the internal desire. If we live in the Spirit, you received the Holy Spirit in your chrismation after your baptism. So if you live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. You cannot say I'm a spiritual person and I'm baptized and receive the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of God abiding in me and you are not walking in the Spirit. So if you receive the Holy Spirit and if the Holy Spirit abides in you, then you need to walk in the Spirit. And as I told you, walking in the Spirit has two dimensions. To grow in the spiritual exercises and also and the virtues and also to crucify the flesh with its passion and desire. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited. Conceited means arrogant. Don't be arrogant, but be humble. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. This is not the fruit of the Spirit, because the fruit of the Spirit is humbleness, gentleness. So, if you live in the Spirit, don't be prideful with your spiritual status, that you are a Christian, and that you achieved all these virtues. Actually, if you are doing this, you are not spiritual. And this will lead to what? To provoking one another and envying one another, which are not the works of the Spirit or the fruit of the Spirit, but the works of the flesh. So in this chapter, St. Paul started by explaining the concept of what does it mean to be free in Christ. Then he spoke about the war between the Spirit and flesh, and he spoke about the works of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. Glory be to God forever. Amen. Do you have any questions about this chapter?